हेलो, आई एम डॉक्टर बंसल वीपी। आई एम फ्रॉम डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ माइक्रोबायोलॉजी, एमजीएम मेडिकल कॉलेज औरंगाबाद। टुडे आई एम टू टॉक अबाउट स्टैफिलोकोकाई, द ओवरव्यू अबाउट स्टैफिलोकोकाई। देर आर नंबर ऑफ स्पीशीज ऑफ स्टैफिलोकोकाई, दे आर इन्फेक्टिंग मैन। द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट स्पीशीज ऑफ स्टैफिलोकोकस इज स्टैफिलोकोकस ऑरियस। इट इज़ द मोस्ट विरुलेंट स्पीशीज। इट कॉजेज अ नंबर ऑफ सपोरेटिव इन्फेक्शंस इन ह्यूमन बींग्स। इट इज़ अ कॉज ऑफ फूड पॉइजनिंग एंड टॉक्सिक शॉक सिंड्रोम। द अदर स्पीशीज इंपॉर्टेंट इज स्टैफिलोकोकस एपिडर्माइडिस। इट कॉजेज इन्फेक्शन ऑफ प्रोस्थेटिक इम्प्लांट्स। थर्ड स्पीशीज विच इज इंपॉर्टेंट इज स्टैफिलोकोकस सैप्रोफाइटिकस, विच इज अ कॉज ऑफ यूरिनरी ट्रैक्ट इन्फेक्शंस, स्पेशली इन वुमेन दे कॉज सिस्टाइटिस। जनरल फीचर्स ऑफ स्टैफिलोकोकाई, द मॉर्फोलॉजी ऑफ स्टैफिलोकोकाई, दे आर ग्राम पॉजिटिव कोकाई इन ग्रेप लाइक क्लस्टर्स। नाउ द नेम स्टैफिलोकोकस कम्स फ्रॉम टू ग्रीक वर्ड्स। द फर्स्ट इज स्टेफाइल। स्टेफाइल मीन्स इन ग्रीक, इट मीन्स अ बंच ऑफ ग्रेप्स। एंड द सेकेंड वर्ड कोकॉस। कोकॉस इज बेरीज। सो दैट इज हाउ द वर्ड स्टैफिलोकोकाई हैज कम। नाउ दिस पर्टिकुलर बैक्टीरिया इज एरोबिक और फैकल्टेटिव एनोरोबिक, सो इट कैन ग्रो इन एरोबिक एज वेल एज एनोरोबिक एनवायरमेंट। नाउ दिस बैक्टीरिया इज अ यूबिक्विटस बैक्टीरिया, सो इट इज प्रेजेंट ऑल ओवर द एनवायरमेंट इन द सराउंडिंग्स। प्लस दिस बैक्टीरिया इज अ नॉर्मल फ्लोरा ऑफ द बॉडी ऑफ ह्यूमन बींग्स। दिस बैक्टीरिया दैट इज स्टैफिलोकोकाई इज प्रेजेंट एज अ नॉर्मल फ्लोरा। द बॉडी पार्ट्स आर इट इज प्रेजेंट ऑन द स्किन, इट इज प्रेजेंट ऑन द इन द नोज, एंड इट इज प्रेजेंट ऑन द म्यूकस मेम्ब्रेन्स। द निच फॉर स्टैफिलोकोकस ऑरियस कैरियर्स इज द नोज ऑफ मैन। नाउ द कल्चरल कैरेक्टरिस्टिक्स ऑफ दिस स्टैफिलोकोकाई। द स्टैफिलोकोकाई एज आई टोल्ड यू इज वॉट इज अ एरोबिक एंड एनरोबिक बैक्टीरिया, फैकल्टेटिव एरोब। सो इट ग्रोज कन्वीनियंटली और प्रॉपरली इन एरोबिक कंडीशंस। इट इज नॉन फैस्टिडियस, मीन्स इट डज नॉट रिक्वायर एनरिच्ड मीडिया फॉर इट्स ग्रोथ। इट कैन ग्रो ऑन बेसल मीडिया सच एज न्यूट्रिएंट अगार। ऑन न्यूट्रिएंट अगार द कॉलोनी मॉर्फोलॉजी इज दैट द कॉलोनी इज स्मॉल, अबाउट 2 to 3 millimeters इन डायमीटर। इट इज सर्क्यूलर, इट इज ओपेक, इट इज ब्यूटरस और मॉइस्ट, एंड इट इज हैविंग अ पिगमेंट विच इज कॉल्ड एज अ गोल्डन येल्लो कलर्ड पिगमेंट। On blood agar, it shows beta type of hemolysis and it will again show the golden yellow pigment. On McConkie's agar, the colonies are very tiny and lactose fermenting pink in color, but usually staphylococci do not grow on McConkie's agar. Then there is a selective medium for Staphylococcus aureus. Now this selective medium for Staphylococcus aureus, which is commonly used, is the mannitol salt agar. Now what is the use of this medium? It is a selective medium. It has got high concentrations of salt. The salt concentration is more than 7 to 8%, and in this salt concentration only Staphylococcus aureus can grow. So it is a selective medium for Staphylococcus aureus, plus it shows the property of mannitol fermentation. Staphylococcus aureus produces is what yellow mannitol fermenting colonies on this medium, whereas all other staphylococcal species will produce is what pink colored colonies, which are non mannitol fermenting colonies. Now we'll see the photographs. There are two photographs. On the left side there is a photograph of Staphylococcus aureus which has grown on blood agar plate. Now you can see the colonies of Staphylococci are as small, circular, and you can see characteristically the golden yellow pigment. And on the right side, there is a culture plate of mannitol salt agar. On the left half of the plate, there is a growth of Staphylococcus aureus, which shows yellow mannitol fermenting colonies. And on the right half of the plate, there is the colonies of other Staphylococci apart from Staphylococcus aureus, which are pink in color, that is mannitol non-fermenting. Now there is one more plate of blood agar which is showing is what characteristic beta hemolytic colonies of Staphylococcus aureus. Now what are the characteristic features of Staphylococcus aureus? Now characteristic features of Staphylococcus aureus are helpful in identifying the Staphylococcus aureus. Now these features are is coagulase, the Staphylococcus aureus is a coagulase positive स्टाफिलोकोकाई, इट इज मैनिटॉल फर्मेंटिंग, इट इज डीएनए टेस्ट पॉजिटिव, इट इज हैविंग बीटा हेमोलिटिक कॉलोनीज ऑन ब्लड अगार, इट प्रोड्यूसेस गोल्डन येल्लो पिगमेंटेड कॉलोनीज, इट हैज द एंजाइम, इट प्रोड्यूसेस द एंजाइम फॉस्फोटेज, इट रिड्यूसेस टेल्यूराइट टू टेल्यूरियम, इट कॉजेज लिक्विफैक्शन ऑफ जिलैटिन एंड प्रोटीन ए कैन बी डिटेक्टेड इन द स्टैफिलोकोकाई. Now, what are the diseases of staphylococci? Diseases of staphylococci are of three types. First is what? It is infection. Second type is what? Is intoxication. And the third type is a combination of both. So, might be at the same time both are present, that is infection as well as intoxication. So, what is infection? Infection, the staphylococci gain entry into damaged skin, mucosa or the tissue. There they colonize, they multiply and cause damage to the tissue. The second is intoxication, in which of the first type of intoxication, the bacteria, that is Staphylococcus aureus, goes inside the body, multiplies and elaborates the toxin and the development of symptoms is there. And the second type, the toxin is elaborated outside the body and the person gets infected. Outside the body, that is in vitro, the toxin is elaborated and the person gets infected with preformed toxin. And the third type of disease I told you is a combination of both infection and intoxication. Now, what are the diseases of staphylococci? What is its pathogenicity? That is the different types of. Now, staphylococci produces different types of diseases. Now, this staphylococci is the most common cause of skin and soft tissue infections that are pyogenic or suppurative infections caused by staphylococci. Now, this staphylococci skin and soft tissue localized infections, to name some, they are folliculitis, they are furuncles, they are impetigo, they are carbuncles, they are styes, or they might produce abscesses in the internal organs. For example, is breast abscesses in lactating mothers, or it can produce abscesses in the muscles, which is called as pyomyositis. Plus, it causes wound infections such as burn infections and infections in patients having trauma. Now, second type of infection produced by staphylococci is localized deep infection. Staphylococcus aureus is the most common cause of osteomyelitis. Secondly, it causes a septic arthritis in children. The other infections produced by staphylococcus is respiratory tract infection, in which the staphylococci produces is bronchopneumonia. It produces pharyngitis, it produces tonsillitis, it produces sinusitis, abscesses, lung abscesses and empyema. Staphylococcus aureus can produce central nervous system infections in the form of brain abscesses, meningitis and intracranial thrombophlebitis. It produces endovascular infections, the endovascular infections being septicemia, pyemia and endocarditis. Now, staphylococcus, they produce urinary tract infection. This urinary tract infection are usually seen after instrumentation or implants and usually seen in patients having diabetes. Apart from this, staphylococci produce is nosocomial infections, which are also called as hospital associated or hospital acquired infections. Now, these infections being is what? Ventilator associated pneumonia. It causes catheter-associated urinary tract infection. It causes surgical site infections, and it also causes is what catheter-related blood infections. The next infection caused by Staphylococcus aureus is food poisoning. Now, this particular infection is because of production of toxin. So, it is a toxigenic manifestation. The toxin is called as an enterotoxin. Now, there are several antigenic types of this enterotoxin. The most common type or the most infections of food poisoning are caused by type A or antigenic type A enterotoxin produced by Staphylococcus aureus. Now, this enterotoxin is produced outside the body, inside the food. So, the food article is where the Staphylococcus gains entry and elaborates the enterotoxin. And the food is later on consumed by an individual. On getting entry inside the body, the food starts acting immediately, and so the incubation period in case of staphylococcal food poisoning is short, which is about 1 to 6 hours, the person gets symptoms. With food poisoning with other bacteria, usually the incubation period is very long. It is about 16 to 8 hours, might be 24 hours. So the incubation period in staphylococcal food poisoning is 1 to 6 hours. What are the symptoms? The symptoms are the patient is having nausea and vomiting. He is having abdominal pain, and rarely there is diarrhea. So again, diarrhea is not there. It is an emetic type of food poisoning. Now, this is self-limiting. Usually, the symptoms subside in about 1 to 8 hours. What is the article of food that is responsible? The articles of foods are, it is meat and milk products. So, it is usually processed or cooked meat. Then it might be vegetables, it might be salads, it might be milk products such as cream, cheese, it might be sandwiches, or it might be cream rolls. So such meat and milk products are the food articles which will be responsible for staphylococcal food poisoning. Now, what is the reservoir? Reservoir is a person who is the handler of the food. So such a person who is handling the food might be a carrier of Staphylococcus aureus, or he might be is suffering or having some lesions on his body which are infected by Staphylococcus aureus. Now, the next infection by Staphylococcus aureus is again because of a toxin, and this infection is toxic shock syndrome. Now, this TSS or toxic shock syndrome is because of an toxin, exotoxin produced by Staphylococcus aureus, which is called as TSST1 toxin, that is toxic shock syndrome toxin 1. Now, this toxic shock syndrome is a multi-system disease. Now, this toxin, it acts as a super antigen. Now, why? What is this super antigen? Now, this toxin acts as a super antigen, meaning that it is going to stimulate T lymphocytes inside the body non-specifically. So, without any specificity for any epitope, different T lymphocytes having different specificities are triggered inside, and there is an immune response, and these T lymphocytes of different specificities are going to release is what cytokines, that is might be interleukin 1, 2, lymphokines, might be tumor necrosis factor, etc. And because of this, there is a multi-system disease. There is excessive immune response, and also there is a dysregulated immune response, and there is florid symptoms in the individual. So that is what it is called, that is why it is called as a super antigen. Now, what are the, if you can see the next picture reveals is what is the tampons. Now, these tampons were used in earlier days by menstruating women, right, and was the cause of toxic shock syndrome. Nowadays, this toxic shock syndrome is seen in all individuals, adults, might be males or females, and usually it follows is what pyogenic staphylococcal lesions, might be skin lesions or abscesses or burns infections, which are followed by is what toxic shock syndrome. Now, what are the symptoms of toxic shock syndrome? The symptoms of toxic shock syndrome are what? They are fever and or chills, there is hypotension, then there might be nausea and or vomiting, there is profuse watery diarrhea with severe abdominal pain, there is mucosal hyperemia in the form of vaginitis and conjunctivitis, there is development of rash over the body which desquamates in 1 to 2 weeks, then there might be headache, there are arthralgias and myalgias, there is a state of confusion, and then there is multi-organ involvement leading to death. The next infection or lesion produced by Staphylococcus aureus is SSSS, which is Staphylococcal Scalded Skin Syndrome, which is an exfoliative skin disease. Now again, this is a toxigenic manifestation of Staphylococcus aureus. It is produced, it is because of an exotoxin by the name of epidermolytic toxin or exfoliative toxin. Now in its severe form, Staphylococcal scalded skin syndrome, it is seen in the form, in the newborns, in the form of Ritter's disease, or in the elderly, it is seen in the form of toxic epidermal necrolysis. And in its milder forms are pemphigus neonatorum and bullous impetigum. Now, what are the symptoms and signs and symptoms of this scalded skin syndrome? The person may have fever. He is having generalized erythema with exfoliation or desquamation. And if you put pressure with the help of a finger onto the skin slides under the finger, leaving below is red raw areas, and the skin is very painful. Now these are all infections we have seen is what infections caused by Staphylococcus aureus. Now we'll see the laboratory diagnosis of Staphylococcus aureus. Now, what are the samples for diagnosis of Staphylococcus aureus? Depends on the lesion or depends on the disease which is there in the individual. So there are different samples which will be coming to the laboratory, which are sent to the laboratory. Now, of this, some of the specimens might be, the most common specimen is pus from suppurative lesions. So it might be skin lesions, it might be abscesses, the pus is collected and it is sent. The next sample is what is sputum. Might be bronchoalveolar lavage, might be endotracheal aspirates from cases of respiratory tract infections. From cases, it might be blood sample, from cases of septicemia, pyemia, endocarditis. It might be a CSF sample from cases of meningitis. It might be feces or remains of food from cases of food poisoning. It might be urine from cases of urinary tract infection. And a rare sample to detect carriers is a nasal swab. Now, how is the sample processed in the laboratory? The sample is processed by doing microscopic examination of the sample, or you do is culture. So both are done. First, we'll see what is microscopic examination of the sample. The microscopic examination is done by doing a smear of the specimen on a slide and doing Gram staining. The Gram staining will reveal is what Gram positive cocci in clusters and might be inflammatory cells in the form of pus cells and macrophages. The sample is collected on culture media. What are the culture media used routinely? The routinely culture medium is used is blood agar and McConkie's agar. Additional selective medium such as mannitol salt agar is required whenever you're isolating Staphylococcus aureus where a mixed flora is expected. For example, when you're doing feces culture or isolating Staphylococci from cases of food poisoning from the food, you will require is mannitol salt agar. So what is the growth character on blood agar? Blood agar you will see is what circular white colonies which are opaque, having a golden yellow pigment and are beta hemolytic. On McConkie's agar, Staphylococci usually do not show any growth on McConkie's agar. If it grows, it will show its tiny lactose fermenting pink colored colonies. On mannitol salt agar, it will show its mannitol fermenting yellow colored colonies. Now you will proceed for identification of the colonies. For identification of the colony, you will first of all do is a catalase test. The catalase test is done on a slide. You take is what? A few drops of 3% hydrogen peroxide, that is H2O2. You pick up the colony with a glass rod, and you put the colony or immerse the colony in the H2O2 on the slide. Immediately there will be seeing is what? You will see is what? Effervescence. Indicates a positive catalase test. Now this catalase test is done as all Staphylococci, any species of Staphylococci is catalase positive, and it differentiates Staphylococci from other cocci such as Streptococci and Pneumococci. So you remember, catalase positive is and identification of Staphylococcus species. The next test you will do is what is a coagulase test. Now, what is this coagulase? Coagulase is an enzyme which is secreted by Staphylococcus aureus and which is not secreted by other species of Staphylococci. So, if this coagulase test is positive, it indicates that the isolate is Staphylococcus aureus. Now, this coagulase enzyme does what? It clots human plasma. So, there is clotting or coagulation of human plasma. So, what does this coagulase do inside the body? It lays a fibrin barrier around the lesion of Staphylococcus aureus. That's why it is said that staphylococcal lesions are localized as compared to streptococcal lesions, which are generalized and spreading type of lesions. Now, how do you do this coagulase test? This coagulase test is done by two methods. One is called as the slide coagulase and the second is called as the tube coagulase. The slide coagulase is going to detect a type of coagulase which is called as bound coagulase, which is called as clumping factor, whereas the tube coagulase detects a coagulase which is called as free coagulase. Now, we will see the picture of the coagulase test. Now, the coagulase test, if the left hand side picture you see or the photograph you see, you will see that it is a photo of tube coagulase test in which the upper tube in which there is no clot formation. So, what is done here is what? Plasma is initially diluted 1 in 5 and you add to it a few drops of broth culture of Staphylococci and incubate it for 5 to 6 hours and look for clotting. So, then the upper tube, if you see, it is a tube which is tilted in the photograph. You can see the clot is not formed and the plasma is still flowing. It indicates a negative coagulase test and it is given by species of Staphylococci other than Staphylococcus aureus. Whereas the lower tube, in which you can see the tilted tube, there is no free flowing of the diluted plasma and you can clearly see the clot there. It indicates that the species isolated is Staphylococcus aureus. Now, we will go to the right side of the slide. The photo on the right side is showing the slide coagulase test, which is done on the slide. You are taking two drops on the slide of saline and in both the drops you are making a smooth suspension of the colony of Staphylococcus aureus. On the left hand side on the slide, on the left hand side drop, you can see a smooth suspension of Staphylococcus aureus. Then on the right hand side, you will put a few drops of human plasma which is sterile and mix the drop into the saline and rock the slide back and forth. In about few seconds, about 30 seconds to 1 minute, you will see is what coagulation or the clot becoming granular, which is clearly seen in the picture, indicates a positive slide test. So, if the isolate is slide test positive and or tube coagulase test positive, it is labeled as Staphylococcus aureus. Now, this is in general laboratory diagnosis for Staphylococcus aureus. Now, there are some tests for detection of toxin. Now, the two toxins of Staphylococcus aureus, that is the enterotoxin and the TSS1 toxin, right? These two toxins can be detected. The tests which are employed for their detection are latex agglutination test, ELISA, and it is the PCR, which are going to detect the genes which are responsible for production of toxin. Now, we will see what are the coagulase negative staphylococci. So, all staphylococci which give a coagulase negative test are called as coagulase negative staphylococci, or they are called as the CONS, C-O-N-S, CONS group of staphylococci. Now, what are this CONS group of staphylococci? There are several species of this staphylococci. To name some common species of this coagulase negative staphylococci, there is Staphylococcus epidermidis, there is Staphylococcus saprophyticus, there is Staphylococcus Lugdunensis, there is Staphylococcus hominis, there is Staphylococcus hemolyticus. And there are other several species of this coagulase negative staphylococci. What are the general features of this coagulase negative staphylococci? Now, the general features are that these staphylococci, they cause nosocomial infections. They are associated with infection whenever implants or prosthetic implants are introduced inside the body, such as cardiac valves, might be joint replacement is there, might be nailing of bones is there, might be there are heart valves involved, or might be there are catheters introduced in the urinary tract. So they are causing is what device associated infections. Now why do these staphylococci cause is device associated infection? Because these staphylococci produce one thing in excess that is called as slime. What is this slime? Is an extracellular capsular material or polysaccharide. This is produced in excess and this settles down on this foreign devices, producing a thing which is called as biofilm. That's why these staphylococci produces such types of infections. Now, what is the difference between these cocci and staphylococci morphologically? Morphologically, coagulase negative staphylococci are gram-positive cocci in clusters and they are not in any way different in morphology than from Staphylococcus aureus. On culture, these staphylococci on blood agar may or may not show beta hemolysis. Usually they are non-hemolytic and they do not produce golden yellow colored pigment. They are usually white in color. The colonies are white in color. If you see the picture or the photograph, you will see that on the left, there is a picture showing the gram staining. You can clearly see gram positive cocci in clusters. So the morphology is similar to Staphylococcus aureus. And on the right side, you will see is what is a blood agar plate having colonies of this coagulase negative staphylococci, which are non-hemolytic and white in color and lacking the golden yellow pigment. Now, what are the infections caused by this coagulase negative staphylococci? The infections caused by this coagulase negative staphylococci are in patients having artificial valves, it can cause endocarditis, it can cause stitch abscess, it causes septicemia, it causes urinary tract infections. Now, this urinary tract infection, the most important coagulase negative staphylococci causing UTI is Staphylococcus saprophyticus. And it is identified by doing novobiocin sensitivity. Staphylococcus saprophyticus is the only staphylococci which is resistant to novobiocin. Rest of all the staphylococcal species will be sensitive. So this is the test for identification for Staphylococcus saprophyticus. Now we'll see is what is the treatment for staphylococcal infection. Now the staphylococcal infection treatment for staph aureus and coagulase negative staphylococci is usually the same. If there is an abscess or something of that sort, the first thing advised is draining the abscess by doing surgery. Now what are the common antibiotics used for treating staphylococcal infections? The antibiotics are penicillins, it might be cephalosporins, carbapenems such as imipenem, meropenem, doripenem, erythromycin, clindamycin, cotrimoxazole are some of the antibiotics. Now these are the antibiotics which are commonly used, but appropriate antibiotics should be selected by the clinician after seeing the antibiotic sensitivity report from the microbiology department. Now we'll see what is the drug resistance in staphylococci. Now staphylococci usually show drug resistance to a number of antibiotics. Now this resistance may be plasmid borne, can be transferred from one bacteria to other bacteria, from one staphylococcus to the other staphylococcus through the process of conjugation, or it might be chromosomal also. The first resistance is by production of enzyme that is beta-lactamase or penicillinase. Now, this type of resistance is seen to the antibiotics that are penicillins. The second type of resistance is mediated by a gene which is called as MECA gene and is chromosomal in nature. Now, this MECA gene is coding for altered penicillin binding sites, which is called as PBP, altered penicillin binding sites. So, if the site for binding of the drug, especially the beta-lactam drugs, is altered, so what will happen? There will be no binding of the drug to the receptors there, to the cell wall there. And this is mediated by this particular gene, which is called as MECA gene. And such a strain of Staphylococcus aureus is called as methicillin-resistant strain of Staphylococcus aureus, which is called as MRSA. That is methicillin-resistant Staphylococcus aureus. It might be seen that the same methicillin resistance is seen in coagulase negative staphylococci, and these staphylococci are called as MR-CONS, that is methicillin resistance coagulase negative staphylococci. Now, what is the significance of this methicillin resistance? If an isolate is labeled as MRSA by doing some tests, then that particular isolate is resistant to all beta-lactam antibiotics and to beta-lactam antibiotic and beta-lactamase inhibitor combinations. So, all beta-lactam antibiotics will not be useful for treatment of staphylococcal infections because of such a strain. Now, how is this detected? It is detected by doing some tests. The tests are oxacillin disc diffusion test, then there is a cefoxitin disc diffusion test, and there is PCR. PCR is the gold standard for detection of MRSA, whereas cefoxitin test is the most common test these days for detection of MRSA and can be done routinely in most of the laboratories and is a surrogate marker for MRSA. Whereas the oxacillin test was done in earlier days, but has been replaced in number of laboratories by the cefoxitin test or the PCR. Now, this MRSA strain, they are present in the hospitals and they cause nosocomial infections there. They are also present in the communities, that is, they are present in the houses also. The strains present in the hospitals are called as hospital-associated or hospital-acquired MRSA strains, and that are present in the community are called as community-acquired or associated MRSA strains. The hospital-associated MR strains are infections are seen in individuals who are operated to the hospital, and they develop infections because of these strains because after some invasive procedures such as surgery, might be catheterization, might be dialysis. Whereas the community acquired strains, the person gets infection in the community and they are usually present in infections such as skin and soft tissue infections, might be abscesses, might be carbuncles, furuncles, burn infections, and they are called as community acquired MRSA strains. Now, there is a limit for treatment for MRSA isolates. Because all the beta-lactam antibiotics and beta-lactam antibiotic and beta-lactamase inhibitor combinations are not going to produce any effect on the MRSA strains. So what are the antibiotics? And usually these are reserved and restricted antibiotics in a hospital setup and should be used very judiciously. Now these antibiotics are vancomycin, teicoplanin, linezolid, daptomycin, quinipristin, and dalfopristin. This is all about is what is staphylococci. Thank you.